this church. Celebrating Christmas 6 months in advance. Donald, crank up the projector. Well, number one, our summer's hot. So when I preach on a cool subject, and I can't think of a greater subject than the advent of Christ, where God promised that he would save humanity. And he sent Jesus to do that. Now, when I first came here in November of last year, one thing I was told, and I think most pastors are told this when they first come to a church, don't change anything. I've been biding my time, trying not to change things. My daughter goes to the Parker Assembly Adventist Church. And I've been listening to the story of their church, of what they're doing in reaching low-income families. Now, those of you who are visitors, this church has a lot of good ministries, like the pantry program, which is reaching 50 low-income families twice a month. Isn't that right, Linda? Twice a month? We have a prison ministry. We have the healthy cooking ministry. And today we're launching a new ministry outreach that happens to be done in Christmas. And so I'm going to give you a few minutes to watch this video that really will explain it better than I can. And then we'll talk more about it.
Throughout the year, members from New Day, Seventh Adventist Church, they buy gifts throughout the year, and then at Christmas time, we put them all in our conference room, and we allow families, and we served over 100 last year, to come shop for their loved ones, their immediate family members. So they get to pick a gift for themselves, their mom and dad, and their siblings, and they get to give what they want to their family members. And it's just the best experience.
The partnership between New Day and Parker Adventist Hospital is just so symbiotic and natural. Our missions overlap in so many ways. We both want to care for the whole person, body, mind, and spirit. You know, the church is really good at the spirit part, and the hospital is really good at the body part. And when we come together, everybody wins. The Christmas store is really a 12-month-a-year experience. We have shoppers starting from the after-Christmas sales the year before, looking for the best gifts for the best prices.
Okay, what do you think? You thought it was getting small?
Oh, look at that!
Or is that too expensive?
Well, see, we can't buy that because Christmas time, nobody will want a super set.
And then those have to be labeled, they have to be stored, they have to be inventoried, and so it is a all-year experience. It's so full, I can't even open it. This is a storage unit where we keep the majority of our gifts that are purchased during the year. And as you can see, they're all inventoried by gender and age. So this is for babies, moms, girls 3 to 7. So the most popular presents are selected each year. They keep track, our shoppers keep track of what sells and what doesn't. Stuff that isn't going, that the kids don't want, gets taken back to stores. Stuff that does sell, they buy more of it. Well, someone gets an invitation at school to come to the Christmas store. It's like their golden ticket. They all get very excited because they know they're going to the Christmas store. They've heard about it at school. They show up on the hospital campus. They're greeted by a warm greeter who then signs them in with their family. The parent is then escorted to a parent room. The child is then matched to a shopper who then takes them around and shops for every person in their family, including that child. Once all the gifts are selected, the shopper takes the child to a gift wrapper who then custom wraps every one of the gifts, and then a volunteer then helps that child take their gifts out to the car. So it's a complete experience.
We do this year after year because there's a need, because it's a way to help our community know that we're not just about healthcare, we're about our community. It's a way for us to work with our church and strengthen that relationship, which I think is so important. It's just something that makes everybody feel good, and it's about others. And I think that's what makes it feel good for everybody.
When the Parker Church started this ministry, and they told they were going to reach 20 low-income families, they laughed. Because see, Parker is the second wealthiest county in the nation, and they weren't sure they had any low-income people. But last year, they ministered to 150 families. So we're starting small, with 20 families. We're using the hospital because our fellowship hall isn't big enough to hold 400 gifts. So we're coordinating with them. When I first came here, I talked to some of the elders, I talked to Lynn, and everybody said, that would be a great idea. Then I went to the CEO of the hospital here in New Smyrna Beach, and he said, that would be a great idea if your church will vote it. And we went to the church board, and they said, that is a great idea. Let's do it. Now, you have an insert in your bulletin that has the mission statement of this ministry. You can find it's called the Christmas for Community Outreach, December 10th to 13th, 2018. Read with me. New Smyrna Beach Seventh-day Adventist Church and the Florida Adventist Hospital propose joining together to represent Christ by bringing joy to 20 low-income families in New Smyrna Beach community. We'd like to bring Christmas joy through providing giving experiences for both children and parents. So that's going to happen December 10th. You can see on the list, we need volunteers. Now, probably late October, early November, we'll do a new insert with one word spelled correctly, where you can begin signing up. I talked to Ken Matherson, and he said several of his staff are very excited about volunteering. So the opportunity for you as Seventh-day Adventists to minister to people of other faiths will be helping out. We're going to need school workers. I've already told you it takes about 45 minutes for the children to go through the store and pick up gifts for themselves, for their siblings, and for their parents. And then they're transferred to the wrappers. Now, we need people who know how to wrap, not like me. Some guests will need to buy bags and put the tissue in there because footballs don't wrap very well. We'll need people to transport the wrapped gifts with the families back to their car. We'll need people to help with the registration. And we need people to go out and buy gifts. And you'll be reimbursed. The goal is to try to buy $20 gifts for every child and get them at half price or less. And to buy $40 gifts for the parents and get them at half price. Which means you need to shop a lot in the year. I went shopping with my wife to Beals, I believe it was. Was it Beals?
Bells.
She went to buy some clothes. And I decided to go to the children's department. That day, all their children's stuff was 60% off. So I said, I'm buying. We're dividing into different age groups. But that's the ministry for December 10th. And I thank you as a church that you're willing to invest in. Thank Lynn and Deborah, who are co-leaders for this ministry. Lynn's already got her hands full with the pantry ministry. it's a great time, great opportunity to minister not only to low-income families, but to minister to the hospital staff who will be volunteering. So now, if you open your Bibles to the book of Isaiah, the 9th chapter.
Isaiah.
No one has to tell you that shopping at Christmas time is hectic. My wife and I lived in Freeport, Louisiana for 15 years. And across town, which is about 14 miles, is where all the shopping was. And in November, we tried to avoid that part of town because the traffic was so intense. One writer put it this way, we celebrate two Christmases, one secular and one religious. He says, the problem is they both happen on the same day, and it sends a confusing message. In Isaiah 9, verse 6, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. By the way, just for a side note, ladies, you did a wonderful job singing that song. And thanks for the narration. That was wonderful. This morning, as we look at those names of Jesus, we're going to focus only on the one, the Mighty God. Jesus is the Mighty God.
Amen.
He is the eternal Son, which is central to our faith. The Bible clearly states that Jesus is fully God and fully man. Isaiah 9:6 says, his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. So the Messiah is known not only as the Son of David, but also as the Son of God. He is King, he is Ruler, and he is Sovereign. Chapter 7 of Isaiah, God's people were under attack. They were under assault. And from a human perspective, it was a losing battle for them. And through his prophet Isaiah, God spoke to the king. And he said to him, make a wish, and I'll give it to you. That's a pretty good deal, isn't it? What do you think the king said? He said, no, I will not make a wish. An excuse he used was he didn't want to tempt God. The reality is, he didn't believe in God. He didn't trust God, and he did not obey God. God said, ask for a sign, and I'll give you a miracle. Now, they needed a miracle. It's amazing how magnificent God is, even to unbelievers. To request a sign, the king would be acknowledging faith in God. And he was unbelieving. And just how gracious God is that he was willing to reach out to this unbelieving king. This king would not ask for a sign for himself, nor for his people, because he would not trust God and he would not obey God. So despite his rejection, God said, then I'm going to give you a sign. It's found in chapter 7 and verse 14, probably one of the best known verses in Isaiah. Verse 14, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel. And Matthew tells us that Emmanuel means God with us. Micah 5:2, God said, I mean, not only am I going to tell you that you have a Messiah, I'm going to tell you where he's going to be born. In the little town of Bethlehem. The New Testament gives us more and more information about the first advent of Christ. But I want to take you to the one, Book of Matthew, chapter 1, and verse 20. Because humanly speaking, it's impossible for a virgin to give birth to a child. And God is saying, I don't work with human possibilities. Matthew chapter 1 and verse 20. But while he thought on these things, he's referring to Joseph, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. Isn't that amazing? Emmanuel, God with us. Now in John chapter 8, Jesus is talking to the scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and they're arguing with him. And they throw a racial slur at Jesus. They called him a Samaritan. And then they said that he was demon-possessed, and to make matters worse, they said he was of the devil. And Jesus responded, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. He saw it and was glad. And the Pharisees laughed because they knew that Abraham had been born 2,000 years before the time in which they were talking to Jesus. And Jesus responded, most assuredly I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. They understood what he was saying. They understood that he was declaring that he was king, ruler, and sovereign. And they were looking for rocks to stone him. What I love about Jesus, about God and the Holy Spirit, is they never change. They are consistent. Hebrews 13:8 tells us that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Isn't that encouraging? God is not fickle. He doesn't change. He makes a promise. He stays with it. Let me illustrate it this way. There's a story I want to share with you. Many of you have probably heard it before. It's about a ship captain. It's dark. They don't have the radar technology that we have today. And so he's looking into the ocean, looking through the clouds, the fog, trying to be sure they don't run into something dangerous. And so he's straining with his eyes, trying to see. And his worst fears are realized when he sees the light of another ship. So to avert disaster, he sends a message to the other ship. This is Captain Jeremiah. Please alter your course 10 degrees south. Well, to the captain's amazement, he heard back from the other ship. Captain Smith, this is Private Thomas Johnson. Please alter your course 10 degrees north. Well, the captain was pretty upset that the private would tell him what to do. So he sent another message. Alter your course 10 degrees south. And the private responded, all due respect, Captain, you need to alter your course 10 degrees north. Angered and frustrated, the captain growled back at this private, I will have you court-martialed. For the last time, I command you on the authority of the United States government, and I am a battleship. The private's final transmission was chilling. Captain Smith, once more, due respect, I command you to alter your course 10 degrees north. I am a lighthouse. See, God's truth is like a lighthouse. It never changes. God does not change to accommodate us. We're the ones that must change. And Jesus is like a lighthouse. The Bible said, like I read in Hebrews 13, He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He will always be there for us. He is dependable. And as Christians, we could form our life to be like Christ. That's what it means to be a disciple. To live your life like Christ would live His. John 14, 6, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The door of salvation is through Jesus Christ. When Pat Robertson was running for the President of the United States, he was an evangelical. And he was on TV, and he was in New York City. And he was asked, what do you tell other people who don't believe that Jesus is the only way? And there's a large delegation of Jewish people who live in New York City, in case you were wondering. I said, what do you tell them? And he said, everybody has to find his own way to heaven. That was heartbreaking. Opportunity to say, Jesus Christ is the only way. Let that be your course. Jesus Christ is the only way. As Paul said in Romans 5, one of my favorite chapters, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God. Through who? Through Jesus Christ. The only key to peace in a sinful world is Jesus Christ. In John 8, 36, Jesus said, If the Son of Man therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. We do not have to be slaves to sin. Jesus has already paid the price for sin. Our choice is, are we going to surrender to Christ? Or are we going to feed our sinful nature? 1 John 1, 9, but if you walk in the light as He is the light, we have fellowship one with another because the blood of Jesus, His Son, cleanses us from most of our sins. All of our sins. I hope a day comes when we'll actually believe that. And yes, we give our lives to Christ, and yes, we still struggle with sin. We still struggle with that sinful nature. God is more than willing to